Hey, what's up guys? Welcome back for another video. If you're new to our channel, please make sure to subscribe as we post videos like these all the time reviewing retro gaming and older technology for modern day use. Today we'll be taking a look at a couple of easy DIY methods on how to play GameCube games in the palm of your hand. But not just that, the method we're about to show you can be done by any average Joe for as little as $100. I know to some $100 might seem like a lot for a portable version of a console that came out almost 20 years ago, but if you have any knowledge of previous options for GameCube portability or are a newcomer to the scene, you will quickly understand how expensive a portable GameCube was just a few years ago. We are able to create the GameCube portables in this video due to the continued advancement of mobile CPU technology in cell phones. They are becoming more and more powerful at a lower cost. Also, another main reason is thanks to the development of the homebrew community for the old Nintendo Wii U. Both of these aspects allow for fluid 60 frame per second gameplay, producing results of how the games originally perform and were meant to be played. In the past, the only way to have a quality portable GameCube experience was to perform an extremely advanced mod using an original GameCube and create a Frankenstein-like portable from multiple off-the-shelf parts. This was not only a challenging task for an extremely talented console modder with electrical engineering experience, but would take months upon years to complete and would cost upwards to $1,000. Of course, if you weren't a professional console modder like these guys, you could pay one of them to commission a unit for you, but again, the weight and cost wasn't feasible for the average consumer. This is in no way meant to knock the portable modding community, as this video is greatly inspired by their work and their desire to make the GameCube portable for anyone. The work that they do is absolutely stunning, and they deserve all the credit in the world. Just like them, the vision of playing endless classic GameCube games on the go has been a dream of mine for quite some time. I had extremely high hopes that when Nintendo announced the Switch, this would become a reality for the masses, but was quickly shot down when Nintendo continued to go in an opposite direction, mainly driven by them not including the Virtual Console feature on the Nintendo Switch that did so well during the Wii generation. The first DIY GameCube portable method we will discuss involves the Nintendo Wii U. As the Wii U was released back in 2012, it has become easily obtainable through eBay or any secondhand reseller website for around $100 to $150. The Wii U used in this video was purchased for just over $100. The hitch with this method is that it is not truly 100% portable. But please, hear me out, you won't be disappointed. But if you are, later in this video, we will discuss a 100% take-anywhere portable. Many didn't know this, but the Wii U was extremely innovative for 2012, as it streamed HD video wirelessly to a handheld gamepad. This may be overlooked as a minor and pointless feature to some, but even today, a device that can broadcast a wireless HDMI signal to another display can cost upwards to $500. What this allowed was to play Wii U games without a TV, and provided more use cases than most people thought, mainly for me, that was playing games while laying in bed, using the bathroom, or just playing in a different room that my consoles were set up in. According to the official Nintendo website, the Wii U gamepad can stream games up to 26 feet away from the console. In most cases, this is enough distance to provide portability throughout one's home. I don't know about you, but when it comes to Nintendo's very own portable console line, I play my 3DS and Switch, mostly at home, in handheld mode, so don't count this first option out just yet. Okay, so getting back on topic, just like the original Wii, the Wii U has GameCube hardware built inside the unit. I know, right? Surprised me too when I found this out. It's believed that the Wii U was going to offer full backwards compatibility for GameCube games out of the box, but was never advertised or supported. Then we thought, hey, they implemented the GameCube hardware inside the unit for Virtual Console support, but again, for some reason, that never came either. The Virtual Console offers games for the Nintendo 64 and the original Wii, but for some reason, they skipped over the GameCube. Maybe Nintendo thought the demand for the GameCube wasn't big enough, or they didn't bother, as support for the Wii U was quite lackluster considering it was Nintendo's worst-selling console of all time. Nonetheless, this didn't stop the modding community from hacking the system and releasing its true inner potential. Come to find out, all that needed to be done was to install a custom firmware onto the Wii U and then install an application called Nintendone. The Nintendone application allows the Wii U to access the GameCube hardware within the console and make it playable. Once successfully installed, you can load GameCube ROM files directly onto the Wii U's hard drive or connect an external hard drive via USB cable. You could even use the original GameCube controller with the adapter bundled with Super Smash Bros. Quickly, the Wii U became the gold standard for playing GameCube games on modern TVs and displays, because unlike the original Wii, it supported HDMI out. This was a GameCube enthusiast's dream, as many believe playing on original hardware is far superior to emulation. Not only that, you can enable 480p progressive scan instead of 480i on almost every game, which slightly improves image quality. Progressive scan was only available on the very first model GameCube that came with a digital out port, which is quite rare and expensive on the reseller market. On top of that, you needed an even rarer component cable, which was only manufactured by Nintendo and sold online, which makes this cable even more expensive for about $200 today. That being said, with or without the component cable, we all know plugging an original GameCube into a modern TV results in an extremely poor image quality. Instead of all that, the modded Wii U method will leave you with a pixel-perfect picture looking like a modern retro game. This brings me to my main point of why making the Wii U into a GameCube portable is an amazing option. Until just last year, it was impossible to play GameCube games through the Wii U gamepad. Prior to 2017, the Nintendone application installed into a modded Wii U could only play GameCube games through an external display. Recently, the developers of Nintendone have made it possible to solely use the gamepad for GameCube gameplay. The Wii U gamepad natively displays at 480p, which is also the same resolution the original GameCube outputted in, making the gamepad gameplay a match made in heaven. The gamepad controls also auto-map to a GameCube controller button layout. This is no small feat for the modding community, as it took them almost 5 years to get Nintendone working on the gamepad. All in all, resulting in the perfect time to jump in. With the ability to get the highest quality GameCube gameplay output on both the TV and the gamepad with a single device, it makes a modded Wii U like a GameCube Nintendo Switch hybrid. If that's not awesome, I don't know what is. The next GameCube portable method we will discuss involves using a smartphone. Specifically, we will be using a Galaxy S9 in this video. As previously stated, the progression of mobile CPU chipsets have resulted in extremely powerful mobile performance at a low cost. Using the smartphone method is much, much easier than modding a Wii U, but costs a bit more. In 2018, a company by the name of Xiaomi released a phone named the Pocophone F1. This was a device not sold in American retail locations, but gained a lot of media attention in the States, as it had the same specs of current flagship devices for only $300. This included a Snapdragon 845. The Snapdragon is one of the best mobile CPUs on the market today. After a few months, I was able to get my hands on one and was absolutely blown away with how well it handled emulation, specifically GameCube emulation. This really brought my attention to the mobile phone market for emulation. I wanted to see if I could find an even better smartphone with a Snapdragon 845 processor for emulation at an even better price and one that was popular here in America. Enter the Samsung Galaxy S9. With the Galaxy S9 being a little over a year old and the Galaxy S10 just releasing, many people will be upgrading their phones. This means the price has drastically dropped on the secondhand reseller market. Some of these people who end up selling and or upgrading their Galaxy S9s still have payment plans or phone bills attached to them that they just stopped paying. This is actually an extremely common occurrence. My brother actually did this last year. When this happens, the cell phone carriers such as AT&T, Verizon, Sprint, and so on will block the phone from ever being able to connect to a cell network again. When this happens, you can obviously no longer use the device to receive a cell signal or mobile data, excluding Wi-Fi, but all other functions remain fully operational. These phones are called bad ESN or bad IMEI phones and can be bought for a fraction of the price. The current market value as of March 2019 on a Samsung Galaxy S9 with a good ESN is about $400 to $500, but one with a bad ESN brings it all the way down to around $250 to $300. Unlike the Pocophone F1 that we discussed at the beginning of this method, the Galaxy S9 has a far superior screen, making it an even better device for portable gaming emulation. The Galaxy S9 is also overall much easier to obtain at a lower price than the Poco phone. To play GameCube games on the Galaxy S9, or any Android phone for that matter, all you need to do is download an app called Dolphin. The Dolphin app is by far the best GameCube emulation app on the App Store. It is being updated all the time and actively supported. Once Dolphin is installed, you can load your GameCube ROM files directly onto the phone's internal storage via USB-C cable or onto a micro SD card. Finally, pick your favorite controller. The Galaxy S9 can hook up to virtually any Bluetooth controller with a click of a button, including the Xbox One and PS4 controller. Within the Dolphin emulator app, there is an option to remap any input from your controller of choice to match the original GameCube controller inputs. You can also hook up any USB-based controller to the Galaxy S9 with an OTG USB-C adapter. Similar to the Wii U method, you can hook up the Galaxy S9 to a modern TV or display by connecting it via a USB-C to HDMI output adapter. This will produce a high-quality, pixel-perfect picture, and just like the Nintendo Switch, you can easily switch from portable gaming to gaming on a TV. I hope you've enjoyed the video today, and it has provided you with some insight on not only the possibilities of portable GameCube emulation, but the possibilities of GameCube emulation in general. As you can probably tell, I'm quite passionate about the GameCube, as it is one of the main systems I grew up on and a major factor of why I love gaming so much today. It gives me nothing but joy to see how far the emulation scene has progressed around this console, and hope it does for you as well. If your eyes enjoyed what they just witnessed, then feel free to subscribe and slap a like on this video. It really helps me out. And if you know someone that is just as obsessed with the GameCube as I am, give this video a share. I think they'll be pleasantly surprised. Later, guys.